Good morning, and welcome as we gather on this day. Big thank you to all the women who were part and anybody else who helped out with the spaghetti dinner last night. I hope all those that attended got well fed, and those that and enjoyed also the ice cream dessert, and those that won in our raffle for their various desserts, I'm sure went home happy and full, and plenty of goodies to have for all. So it was a wonderful time, a real nice time of fellowship and a good fundraiser, and I appreciate all the hard work that was done there, and my tummy thanks you too. Let's see, what else is going on? Next week, I mean, it's hard to imagine, it's Super Bowl Sunday next week already, on the 11th, on the 12th, and I don't know where, January just zipped by. I can't believe this is February 5th. And anyway, so next week is Super Bowl Sunday. We will be collecting on, right? It is next week, right? Yep. And we will be collecting for the food bank. So bring your extra change or loose cash or whatever to put in the bin, the soup pot that we're collecting. And also there will be soup. Is that going to be out there or downstairs? Out there? Oh, okay. You're going to trust us to eat soup in the chapel. Okay. Anyway, there's soup in the chapel also afterwards. So, so that'll be Super Bowl Sunday. And also, you're welcome to bring any canned goods or any other non-perishable foods for the food bank at that time as well. There's quite the competition going on between the Sunday school students and the teachers. So far, the students are ahead in how much they have brought in. So I don't know if the teachers are going to make up for that or not. But choose your side and add to it if you want. But bring in food. Other than that, Lent is coming up soon. We have the Shrove Tuesday pancake supper done by the youth group. That's in your bulletin, as well as, of course, then we'll have Ash Wednesday on February 22nd, 11 and 7 worship services for Ash Wednesday, and then we'll start our Lenten series the following week at 11 and 7. We'll have the worship service, morning prayer at 11 o'clock with soup following, and then in the evening we'll have supper and a study, devotional worship study slash all combined into one in the evening, where we'll be looking at the Ten Commandments. So that's what we have coming up. Any other joys or concerns? I do want to lift up to everyone who may not have heard that Bill Linder died this past week. His funeral will be here tomorrow at noon. There's visitation down at the funeral home today starting at 4 o'clock. And then also tomorrow morning before the service, they're down at Brent's. Anything else? If not, I ask all those that are able to please stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin together. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven. In the name of Christ the Savior. Amen.
Amen.
the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Lord God, with endless mercy, you receive the prayers of all who call upon you. By your Spirit, show us the things we ought to do, and give us the grace and power to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I invite the kids to come on up. How you doing? I'm going to sit down here this time. I'm going to be brave and see if it works to sit. Oh, I made it. Now we'll see about getting up again. But anyway, how you doing today? Oh, hi. Hey, how you doing? So anyway, last week I talked to you about how there's no may in the blessings that we hear from the church, right? There's no may. Well, today I want to talk to you about something else. Today, in our reading, Jesus is talking to people, and he's talking to his disciples, and he says, you. And when we hear you, like when I say, hi, you, who am I talking to right then? Who was I talking to? How you think I was talking to her? I was actually talking to all of you. How do you know the difference? How do you know the difference in our language, in English, whether or not I'm talking to you or you? Yeah, how do you know the difference? It's hard, right? Well, and so when we read these passages where Jesus is saying, you ought to do this, we sometimes think, oh, that's all about me. It's just what I need to do. But you know what? If you read in the original language the Bible was written in, was Greek. And in Greek, they have a way of showing whether or not it's single, you know the term singular or plural, right? Whether it's singular for one person or plural for others. And when Jesus says you in our story today, he's not saying you, he's saying you. Now, the neat part is we don't have it in the English language, but in Pittsburghese we do. Right? In Pittsburghese, we can say yinz. Yinz. Right? Jesus says to yinz, love each other. All right? Yinz, love each other. So I want people, when you read hear this scripture today, when Jesus talks to people about you are the light, you are salt and light. That's what he says. So you are the light of the world. You are salt of the earth. It's actually yinz. Yinz are the salt and light of the earth. All right, yinz. Because because you see, Pittsburghese allows us to do that. If we lived in the South, it would be y'all. But in Pittsburgh, it's yinz. So that's the thing I want to show is that it's important to remember that it's not just about me. It's about the church. It's about all of us together to be the light of the world, to share Christ's love with others, to be salt, to season the world with God's love. And to show you that, I want to show something here. See, what do I have here? What is that? A strainer. Yep, I'm going to show you this here. I'm straining my voice. All right, now I want to show you. Can you do me a favor? Can you come over here? Can you hold this just like this? Let's see if I can turn on my flashlight mode on my phone here. See, I didn't have to bring an extra flashlight today because if I can make this work. Now, I want you to come here. Come here, all guys. Come on over here. Now, what do you see? Here, this is the flashlight. It shines bright. But if I put this here, what do you see?
It shows circles.
Yeah, it shows a whole bunch of them, right? And actually, in this one, because of the pattern on the strainer, it shows a star, which is actually kind of appropriate because we have our Epiphany star hanging there. But it makes us like a star showing all those little points of light. So we, as the church, share the light of Jesus with the world, but it's not just one dot of light, it's everybody together. And together we are the church. Just like all those different points of light right there that come out and have that star shape there. So let's pray. Good and gracious God, we give thanks that you are that your Son came into the world to show us how to best love you and others. Help us be a light. Be one of many as the church gathers. Because in baptism, we are all told to let our light shine before others that others may see your good works. Lord, we ask you to be with us this day and with our families. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up. And let's see if I can turn this off and not wear down my battery.
Good morning. It's 6 centuries before the life of Jesus of Nazareth. The people of Israel have returned from 50 years of Babylonian exile in 539 BC. Yet there's confusion and unrest. The people say they're doing what they believe they're supposed to be doing to please God. However, they are rebuked. In our reading, God speaks through the prophet. In the midst of their joyful return to their promised land, God issues judgment on them and uses the prophet to instruct the people in genuine fasting, resulting in acts of justice, such as feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, and clothing the naked. A reading from the 58th chapter of Isaiah. Shout out! Do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interests on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose? A day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. The word of the Lord. We'll now sing responsively Psalm 112.
Oh,
Though people such as the Corinthians are enamored with human philosophy and wisdom, Paul continuously presents God's hidden wisdom, which is Jesus Christ crucified. True spiritual maturity involves judging ourselves and others in light of God's revelation in the cross. A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, the second chapter. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature, we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish, but we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also, no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. The word of the Lord.
Reading from Matthew, the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Our reading from Matthew continues the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus has taken his disciples up the mountain a bit. And we continue from last week when we heard about being blessed. We can now turn to when Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth." Yins are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. Yins are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you on this day, in the name of God the Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, as I mentioned, today's gospel is a continuation of last week as the Sermon on the Mount, as we call it, continues. Jesus has left the crowd and gone up on the mountain a bit to be alone with his disciples and to teach them. But when you think about it, picture it in your mind, they are not isolated, right? They didn't hide behind a rock or probably or go into some woods or anything, because there's always this huge crowd of people still there in need. They're right there at the base of the mountain, still needy. Faith is not lived out separate from the rest of the world, separate from those we call other. The needs of the least of these is always in the background of this account of Jesus talking to the disciples and in real life. So as we heard last week, Jesus teaches the disciples who they are. That no matter what circumstances and what society says, you are the beloved of God, blessed, and you have a place in the kingdom of God. An identity is important. Knowing who and whose you are is very important. It grounds us, it centers us, it prepares us for whatever life might bring. The disciples, and you and I, have been gifted the identity as blessed children of God. But then Jesus goes on now to describe what that identity really looks like. How is it personified in disciples like you and me? Well, it looks like salt and light. Now, salt back then was not just a tasty seasoning that we generally eat too much of. Salt was essential for survival. The body actually needs salt in certain amounts. But even more important to the first century world, it was needed to preserve food, especially in those days without refrigeration. Without salt, therefore, humans could not survive long. So to be salt is to be life-giving, life-preserving, life-saving. And light, well, light was the banisher of darkness. It brings warmth and cheer. In the time before electricity, dark was really dark. Everything stopped at sunset, unless there was a light. The light from a few oil lamps allowed activity to continue after dark, whether it be work or play. And out in the darkness, was the scary, the unknown. Ask any toddler whose nightlight has burned out, right? To be light is to be a bringer of comfort and joy and opportunity into a world of darkness and dread. And the amazing thing is, Jesus doesn't say to the disciples, if you want to become salt and light, you need to do this and that. Or he does not say, Before I call you guys salt and light, I need to see this from you. No, rather he says simply and directly, you are salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. All of you, plural. As it is with last week's Beatitudes, sheer blessing and affirmation of a pre-existing identity. The fact is, as the blessed ones of God, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. And that's the way it is. And that's the way it's going to stay. Period. But it's also important to note, it's one thing to know and to claim your identity, but it's an entirely different thing to live it and to live into it. We've been given a gift and a calling. I'm reminded of the line in the Spider-Man movies, if you remember, with great power comes great responsibility. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. These are great and holy gifts, a blessing. But with this blessing comes great responsibility, the responsibilities of discipleship. What you do when you find out that you are salt and light to the world, what do you do? What does that mean for us as individuals? What does that mean as a church together here in this place called Perrysville? Jesus asked, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything, but it's thrown out, trampled underfoot. But think about it. Salt cannot lose its saltiness. It's in the nature of it. Was Jesus using some alternative facts? No. We cannot lose the saltiness and light that we've been given. But you know what? We can sure forget we have it. We can forget that we're salty. I think Jesus and everyone around him knew full well that saltiness, that salt can't lose its saltiness, that God's promise with God's people doesn't allow for anyone to be thrown out or trampled underfoot. Humanity, each one of God's precious children, is the salt of the earth. We can't ignore this gift we've received and our call to live out our identity as a light to the world. We may need to remember the difference that being salt and being light means. The question is, do you know who you are? Do you believe who you are? You are the beloved, and you are salt and light. This is not something to be earned. It's who you are, just like the color of your eyes or your genes for male pattern baldness. It's who you are. Or do you doubt what Jesus says? Do you doubt that in this account, Jesus meant you, one who has been sealed by the Holy Spirit, marked with the cross of Christ forever, a beloved child of God? Do you hesitate, wondering whether or not this is the right time or the right place to share the light? I mean, what'll other people think? Or have you convinced yourself that in this conflicted world, your voice really can't make a difference, so why risk it? For too long, especially in the wide church, many of us have allowed our light to be hidden, even extinguished. We are church inside a building when we gather, but that light doesn't shine very far out of the church basement at times. But now, more than ever, the life-giving salt and revealing light of Christ needs to be shared in a hurting and very confused community, nation, and world. if you had lost your taste, if your light seems to need some new batteries, then you may need to ask yourself why. Traditionally, we Lutherans have looked on these tough passages like this and been certain that the whole purpose is to reveal God's impossibly high standards, that, oh, we cannot possibly do that, to drive us to the forgiving gospel of Jesus Christ. But sometimes I think that could be simplistic, to just reduce this to an impossible standard. I can't be salt. I can't be light to the world. Something that we can never live up to. And even though that may be the reality, we can't fully live into it. But as those that are blessed and called to hunger and thirst for righteousness, we are to be salt and light for the world, no matter how difficult. But what it does drive us to is the reality that we cannot do it alone. This message can drive us to Christ as the way to live this out in our daily lives. Not to shrug it off as, oh, that's impossible, I'm just going to go back and do what I normally do. It's in Matthew's gospel we find out that Jesus is known as Emmanuel, God with us. We hear the promise where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among you. And in chapter 28, we hear, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. We are not alone. It is not just up to us alone. We can let our light shine through our faith in the gracious presence of Christ with us, among us. It's our faith in Christ that we can let our light shine. For as Martin Luther wrote, faith is a living, creative, active, and powerful thing. And he goes on to write in his preface to the book of Romans that faith is living, a living, bold trust in God's grace, so certain of God's favor. Such confidence and knowledge of God's grace makes you happy and joyful and bold in your relationship to God and all creatures. This week, I invite you to notice where you see that light shine and where there is life-giving, life-sustaining, life-saving salt. At work, out and about in the grocery line or at the bank. Also, notice where you might have opportunities to be that life-giving salt or joyous light to others, be it in your family, school, workplace, out and about in town, even in that grocery line. Luther also wrote, faith cannot help but doing good works. You are blessed. You are, yins are, the salt of the earth and the light of the world. In faith, you live out that gift and are called daily as children of God, sealed by the Holy Spirit, marked with the cross of Christ forever. We remember how in our baptism we are told, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory, not to yourself, but to your Father in heaven. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died,
and was buried.
He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting.
Amen.
As we come together in prayer, at the end of each intercessory petition, we ask God to receive our prayer. Call your people everywhere to seek your wisdom and counsel in difficult conversations and actions. Give the church in every land leaders with courage to call for repentance for our history of intolerance and injustice practiced on those who are different from us. As you spoke through the prophets to the people of Israel, lead us to bring the homeless into our house, to give clothing and shelter to the naked, to reconcile with our family, and to help the afflicted. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Lord, your creation inspires wonder and awe from the first light of dawn to the quiet beauty of the night. Forgive us for the damage we have done to our earth. Inspire us to work to heal the scars we have inflicted. Help us restore the natural balance we have disrupted. Bring healing and hope to lands and communities experiencing natural disasters, especially the victims of drought in East Africa. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Dear Lord, you sent Jesus of Nazareth to bring good news to the poor, the oppressed, the outcasts of society. Instill in us wisdom to raise up leaders in government and business who recognize oppression and will work to end it. Leaders who seek the damage income equality does in our society and are willing to reverse it. Politicians who will heed your call for nations to practice righteousness. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Almighty God, your mercy is steadfast. Provide sanctuary to people who flee from oppression, war, poverty, and famine. We pray for Ukrainian refugees, for those who have left everything and walked to our border seeking asylum in this country. Be with and sustain healthcare workers, caregivers, first responders, counselors, and all who help and heal. Comfort those among us who are grieving or experiencing crisis. We pray especially for Rachel, for John, for Mindy, for Penny, for Matt, for Robin, for Aiden, for Eric, for Mary, for Liam, for Allison, for Carol, for Janet, for Frank, for Elizabeth, for Russ, for Grace, for Anne, for Nancy, for Jean, for Bob, for Joan, for Bob, for Gary, for Joan, for Mark, for Eli, for Carol, for Bob, for Jeff. Merciful God, we pray for our faith community, and especially we pray for our call committee at St. John's. Shape our congregation to be salt for the earth. May we find inspiration in the good news of Jesus, and may we live the commandments so that we are generous with those in need. Make us steadfast in our trust in you, ready with tangible mercy and compassion for our neighbors. Support this congregation in its search to call a pastor to lead the church in word and sacrament. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Dear Lord, you are timeless and your presence is constant. Your compassion and love endures throughout all generations. We are thankful for those in our extended family who have gone before us and who have died in Christ. We pray that their example, their life, inspires us to share and to pass on the good news of your love and healing power. We pray that we may be united with them and all the saints in Christ's resurrection life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer. We bring to you all our needs and all our hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power that is revealed in Christ crucified and risen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
Also with you.
Share this gift of God's peace.
God's peace.
God's peace. morning prayer, liberating God.
You break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Lift
up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him to be your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O holy God. You are the light and life of all. By your powerful words, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light, shining into our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us and this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, on earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Come and taste and see the joy of God.
Thank you. body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
It's the blood of Christ shed for you.
Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in grace.
Amen. Let us pray. Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you. Amen.
The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and uphold you today and always.
Amen.